Good afternoon and welcome to the Department of Radiology and Radiology. Today we have a special guest speaker, Dr. Shinaz Elika. Dr. Shinaz Elika is applying for a position in neuroradiology. She is from India. She finished medical school in 1996. In Padma Shri, Dr. D.Y. Patil Medical College in Mumbai, India. In the year 2000, did the radiology residency in January, and in October held the India board in the Popliwala National Medical College, also in Mumbai. In 2001, did the first neuroradiology fellowship at the National Institute of Mental Health and Neurosciences in Bangalore, you know, in the southern part in India, Sai Baba.
Yeah,
and there's also in 2004, there is a series of American fellowships. It was a research fellowship at Henry Ford Health System in Detroit. In 2011, was America Board Radiology certified. And from 2008 to 2014, she is completing five fellowships in neuroradiology. Three in adult neuroradiology, including pediatric neuroradiology. She currently is in Philadelphia, completing her second neuroradiology fellowship that will end in August. So she will be available to work after post-fellowship in Japan. She has published 20 papers in peer-reviewed journals. Is the author and co-author of four book chapters, has 56 presentations, and several awards as a medical student and as a presenter in international media. So,
Today I'm going to be talking about imaging of congenital hearing loss. And it's a topic which kind of interests me a lot, and I'm just going to be addressing a few issues, and I have my...
Do you have a phone or something with you?
Yes, I do. I think it's in the bag. You can take this the bag away. So the learning objectives for today's talk are to review the embryology of the external middle ear and inner ear structures, to review causes of congenital hearing loss, and then we'll see a couple of examples of imaging studies in children with congenital hearing loss, and then I just want to kind of specify for some of my radiology colleagues over here notes on imaging techniques and which imaging modality to use and what are the different new things that are available. Congenital hearing loss is basically one of the most frequent birth defects that are seen. Early detection is critical for auditory rehabilitation, and the universal neonatal hearing screen has altered management of childhood sensorineural hearing loss in America. In the fact that it's reduced the age of diagnosis from 24 to 30 months to almost 2 to 3 months. So we'll just go over some of the imaging modalities that we can use. CT is usually the first modality in most workup, but MRI is being increasingly used. So MRI can be used as a complementary modality to CT. And what I've seen in my experience is that it's being increasingly used because parents are very concerned about the CT effects of radiation. And also it can be used as a first line modality in cases, example, if the clinicians are suspecting CMV infection, you usually want to go to MR directly because you're not going to see much on the CT. Not that you cannot see, but you want to basically directly go to an MR. You don't want to work the patient up doing two studies. So what we do with the high resolution temporal bone CT is basically we do a non-contrast scan. Usually it's sub-millimeter slice thickness. And where I've trained, what they do is they acquire the images in the axial plane and then they reconstruct it in the plane of the lateral semicircular canal so that you have one axial plane where you see the entire semicircular canal, the lateral semicircular canal opened up in good view. And then we do reformatted images. So one routine reformat that we do is the coronal plane where we do the coronal reformats. In addition, we do these two reformats. One of them is called the Pochel view and the other one is the Stenver's view. So the Pochel view is basically in the plane of the superior semicircular canal. So what you do is, for the radiology residents, you scroll over the axial images, you obtain the section where you can see the two crura of the superior semicircular canal, and then you join the dots. And then when you obtain reformats in that plane, you basically open up the whole superior semicircular canal. And also this is a good view that I've noticed that it's a very good view to look also at the vestibular aqueduct because it opens up the entire vestibular aqueduct. The other view is the Stenver's view, which is actually perpendicular to the Pochel's view. So it opens up, you can actually see the turns of the cochlea, as well as also you cut the superior semicircular canal, and you can see its bony covering pretty well. So with MR, what do? Most of the times, this MR is going to be a non-contrast MR. So we try to do 3D T2, heavily T2-weighted sequences. So it's your choice whether you want to do a CIS or a Fiesta, or you do a 3D T2 space. At CHOP, they basically do two, just in case if one of the images are motiony, the second one might help. And when I trained at Boston, what they did was they did these direct sagittal oblique T2-weighted images through the IAC so that you would get direct images, not reformats through the IAC. So it depends. Every place is different. But I think both places have their advantages and disadvantages. And it's basically your training and how comfortable you are reading those kind of scans. So this is what they do at CHOP. Here you can see this is an axial 3D T2 space image, and this is how the coronal reformats are done. They're done parallel to the IAC, and this is how it looks. This is for the left side. This is the way they do the sagittal reformats. You actually go perpendicular to the IAC, and these are basically the sagittal reformats. This is anterior, this is posterior, so you basically open up the IAC. So now I just want to initially talk about external auditory canal atresia and the external and middle ear anomalies so that we can get done with, and then we'll talk about the sensorineural hearing loss. So the external ear basically consists of the EAC and the pinna. The middle ear includes the tympanic cavity, the eustachian tube, as well as the ossicles. So in the embryonic life, what happens is that you have these mesodermal condensations called the branchial arches. And during development, these branchial arches get separated from one another on the external skin surface by clefts. And on the endodermal side, with further development, you get these pouches. So the first pharyngeal cleft gives rise to the external auditory canal, and the first pharyngeal pouch gives rise to the middle ear cavity as well as the eustachian tube. Now the mesoderm of the arches basically gives rise to your ossicles of the middle ear. Both these two arches contribute to the ossicles. So like we discussed, this is a pharyngeal cleft. On the external surface, it gives rise to the external auditory canal, and here you can see the pharyngeal let me concentrate on the cleft. So what happens is the cleft is that the cleft forms the external auditory meatus. Then a solid plug of cells forms at the bottom of the cleft between the at around third month. Between fifth and seventh month, the plug splits and forms a canal. And then a failure of recanalization basically results in EAC malformations and atresia. How does the external ear develop? There are six small swellings called the auricular hillocks, which surround the first pharyngeal cleft, and they combine to form the auricle. And this is how these are the hillocks, and then they kind of combine to form the external ear, the pinna. So how does the middle ear develop? The middle ear develops from the first pharyngeal pouch. The distal portion of the pouch is called the tubotympanic recess, and it gives rise to the middle ear cavity. The proximal portion gives rise to the auditory tube or the eustachian tube. Before birth, the middle ear cavity is filled with fluid, but after birth, it gets replaced with air. And like I said, the ossicles basically develop from the mesoderm, and initially, they're in close contact to the pharyngeal pouch. And then what happens is that the pharyngeal pouch kind of engulfs these ossicles and enlarges so that the ossicles form a bridge across the cavity. So this is just esoteric. I mean, if people want to remember, basically head and neck of malleus, body and short process of incus arise from the first arch. Manubrium of the malleus, long and lenticular process of the incus and the stapes superstructure arises from the second arch. So abnormalities of the external ear, I don't want to concentrate much on it because it's something which is very evident to the clinician. So we'll just touch this briefly. But what I want to state over here is basically when you see EAC stenosis or atresia, it's very important to look at the clinical notes. You want to see if the mandible is normal or not, because you want to assess whether this is a syndromic external auditory canal atresia or it is non-syndromic. So if it is a normal mandible, most likely than not, it's going to be a non-syndromic EAC atresia. Whereas if you have micrognathia, then you want to start thinking of the syndromic causes of EAC atresia, including Treacher-Collins, hemifacial microsomia, Nager's, Apert's, etc. And then you want to assess whether the micrognathia is unilateral or bilateral. And we'll go over it in detail as I go through. I don't want to kind of stress too much on this because this is something which is very evident to the clinician. But then there are genetic and environmental causes of microtia. So let's get to external auditory canal atresia. As I discussed in the embryology, we know that there's a common embryologic origin of the EAC as well as the middle ear. So when you have abnormalities of the external ear, invariably you have abnormalities of the ossicular chain as well as the middle ear cavity. hold it like this. I think it's easier. So most likely than not, the patients present with conjunctive hearing loss, and CT temporal bones plays a very important role in surgical planning as well as, we'll go over this. So basically, there's this good paper, and these people have published a paper in 1992, and they talk about this 10-point score, which predicts the postoperative improvement of basically, it's based on HRCT temporal bone findings, and it scores the likelihood of successful surgery. So they're given points to these various structures, and these are the structures that the radiologist should pay attention to and actually mention in the reports. So an important point is to look for the stapes, because if it's abnormal, then the ossicular reconstruction is difficult. You want to look for the facial nerve, and then the other structures which I've mentioned here, especially the oval window, whether there's oval window atresia or stenosis. You want to look for mastoid pneumatization. You want to see if the middle ear space is small. If it is small, is it opacified? Is it aerated? So basically, the bottom line is, if it is bilateral atresia, a score of 5, and if it is unilateral, a score of 7 makes them good surgical candidates. So these are examples. This is a patient with a normal external auditory canal. This patient has a perforation, also has a tympanostomy tube in situ. But look at this. This is stenosis of the external auditory canal, the bony portion. This is complete atresia of the bony canal. And you can see there's a bony plate. And this bony plate can be either non-pneumatized or variably pneumatized. In this case, it's pneumatized, but it's opacified. You want to assess the middle ear cavity. In this case, the middle ear cavity is small. You can see very dysplastic ossicles. Many a times, these ossicles are fused to the bony atretic plate. And in this case, you can also see that the ear is small, so this patient also had microtia. Like I mentioned, when you see bilateral external auditory canal atresia, you want to think of the syndromic causes. The examples include, hemifacial microsomia, Treacher-Collins, Robband sequence. So you want to look for the syndromic causes. So this is an example of Treacher-Collins syndrome. You can see over here the patient has a small mandible. You can see over here there's small external auditory canal. This is actually the patient also had a bone-anchored hearing aid. You can see abnormal pinna. You can see over here there's stenosis of the external auditory canal. You can see the middle ear cavity is very small, and the ossicles are dysplastic. Look at the stapes. You don't see the anterior crus of the stapes in this case. Most importantly, look at the oval window. Normally, you should see a gap in the bone at the level of the oval window. Here, you see complete oval window atresia, and you can see that the facial nerve should be actually beneath the lateral semicircular canal. What you're seeing here is the facial nerve is at the level of the oval window. So this is something that you want to put in your report so that the surgeon is known, is alerted about this. So what is the checklist? You want to look at the atresia plate. You want to see if it's bony versus membranous. If it is bony, you want to note the thickness on your report. You want to report the size of the middle ear cavity, whether it's normal, small, is it pneumatized, is it opacified. You want to look at the status of the ossicular chains. Like we said, is it ankylosed to the ball? How are the malleoinchidal as well as the inchidostapedial joints? Is the oval window present? How is the stapes looks? Because if the stapes is not present, the ossicular reconstruction is difficult. And then, like I said, importantly, trace the course of the facial nerve, as an aberrant nerve may be at risk during surgery. And I just want to kind of show you examples. This is a patient with external auditory atresia, and you can see that the stapes superstructure is normal. This is a patient with an abnormal stapes. Again, showing you the lateral bony atretic plate, you can see the ossicular mass fused to the bony atretic plate. You can see over here there is oval window atresia, and you can see the facial nerve is at the level of the oval window. And then you can also see in this patient that the facial nerve is basically more anteriorly located. You should never see the descending mastoid segment of the facial nerve at the level of the lateral semicircular canal. It's usually behind it. So if you see it at the same level, you know that it's more anteriorly displaced. So those are the things that you want to alert your clinician about. I won't kind of go into the treatment because I have a lot to talk about. So let's get to the major chunk of my talk, which is congenital sensorineural hearing loss. Now, basically, there are various causes of this. The two most important causes are basically the environmental causes, which account for around 35% of the cases. And the bigger chunk is basically the genetic causes. The genetic causes are further divided into the syndromic and non-syndromic, of which the non-syndromic forms a big chunk. Now, in the environmental causes, there are a variety of conditions that can give rise to it. They're up on the slide. But the most important one that I'm going to stress on is CMV infection. And amongst the syndromic, I'll be doing a whole section on syndromic. I'll be touching on the ones which are clinically, rather radiologically relevant to us, where we make a difference in the diagnosis. So we'll talk about CHARGE, BOR, Wardenburg, Pendrid, X-linked hearing loss. And then the non-syndromic ones, I'll talk a little bit about the GJB2 mutation. So this is actually, amongst the non-syndromic hearing loss, this GJB2 mutation is frequent. And this GJB2 mutation, basically, the GJB2 encodes for a gap junction protein, which is called connexin 26, and it's found in a big group of these patients who have got this non-syndromic form of sensorineural hearing loss. So let's look at CMV. In CMV, what you we basically see it in around 20 to 30% of all cases of hearing loss. Most of them present with sensorineural hearing loss. And at a pathological level, what they have is endolymphatic labyrinthitis, and it is beyond the resolution of imaging. So when you actually image the temporal bones, you don't see anything. But you see other things in the brain which actually help us in narrowing the differential diagnosis and suggesting CMV as the cause of hearing loss. So I just want to kind of show you what we see. On imaging, what you see, let me go back, show you this. This is actually a cartoon showing you what you some of the findings. You see basal ganglia calcification, but most commonly the calcification is periventricular in location. You see a lot of white matter injury, so you see gliosis as well as demyelination. Very commonly you see polymicrogyria or agyria, pachygyria, and we'll look at some of the images. And the other thing that is not many people know about is that you see cerebellar hypoplasia. So that's also something that you want to think about when you see a lot of these cases, you will see that cerebellar hypoplasia is also common. There's an example, I don't know if it's projecting well, but this patient has mild inferior Wurmian hypoplasia. This is an example showing florid CMV infection. You see a lot of calcifications. They are scattered in the periventricular location as well as also in the basal ganglia. And you can see there's a lot of white matter hypodensity. So that's basically a combination of gliosis as well as demyelination. The MR kind of shows you all the findings so much more better, and you appreciate the malformations of cortical development also much better. So what you see over here is, if you look closely, look at the cortex here. It's got this very lumpy, bumpy appearance. So there's polymicrogyric cortex here. I don't know if it's projecting well, but look at the cortex here. This is not normal cortex. It's got this lumpy, bumpy appearance. And look at the white matter. I've seen this being misdiagnosed as leukoencephalopathy more times than one. But classically, these patients have temporal lobe cysts. They have these germinolytic cysts. I don't know if it's projecting well, but they have these germinolytic cysts. And we also do these SWI images basically to pick up calcification. So you can see all the periventricular as well as the basal ganglia calcifications. And these changes can also be seen in the cerebellum. So now I'm just going to concentrate a little bit on embryology, and then we'll look at the other inner ear malformations. So the otic placoid develops on the surface ectoderm adjacent to the hindbrain. It basically develops as a surface thickening. Then it invaginates to form the otic pit, and then it completely separates to form the otic vesicle. A group of small cells separate from the otic vesicle. It's called the statoacoustic ganglion, which gives rise to the vestibulocochlear nerve. And then the otic vesicle further divides into three components. So you have a utricular portion, a saccular portion, and the endolymphatic sac and duct. Now the saccular portion gives rise to the cochlea. We'll look at that first. The saccular portion develops a small tubular outgrowth that kind of enlarges and coils to form the cochlea. And at around the 10th week, the cochlea undergoes vacuolization to form all its chambers as well as the modalis and the spiral ligament. What about the utricle? So the utricle is formed from the utricular portion of the otic vesicle. Initially what happens is that there are small flattened outpouching which arise from the utricle. You can see that this is in cross-section. You can see there's these flat outpouchings. Then what happens is that the central portions of these outpouching oppose, and then they disappear. And then the one end dilates to form the ampulla. And the general rule is that the superior semicircular canals forms first, then the posterior, and then the lateral is the last one formed. So if you have abnormalities of the superior, invariably you have abnormalities of the posterior and lateral semicircular canal. Whereas if you have just lateral semicircular canal abnormalities, they're usually isolated. The posterior and superior semicircular canals are normal. The exceptions to the rule are two conditions. One of them is Waardenburg syndrome, and the other one is Alagille syndrome, which are basically syndromic causes of abnormalities in the posterior semicircular canal, and in which you have just abnormalities of the posterior semicircular canal without involvement of the superior or lateral semicircular canal. So those are the two exceptions to this general rule. So actually, the radiological classification of cochlear malformations was the initial one, and I think that this is what we mostly use in the radiology world, is by Senaroglu and Sachi, and this is in order of decreasing severity. You start with complete labyrinthine aplasia, and I'll just show it to you on the picture so it's easy to understand. One is complete labyrinthine aplasia. You don't get any formation of the inner ear structures. Then you have cochlear hypoplasia, where you have some dysplastic vestibule but no cochlea. Then you have the common cavity, where there is a otic vesicle, but there's no differentiation into cochlea and vestibule. Then you have the incomplete partition one, where it is further developed. So you see some separation into cochlea and vestibule, but the cochlea and vestibule are not fully developed. So you have this featureless appearance. Then you have this, which is cochlear hypoplasia. We have incomplete number of turns of the cochlea. This is incomplete partition type two, where there is incomplete, or rather a lack of partition between the apical and middle turns. And then this is normal. And we'll go over most of these conditions, and I've got a lot of clinical image pictures, so, you know, the imaging pictures, so we can go over these. The first one is cochlear malformations. So this is also called Michel's aplasia, and this is the arrested development is during the third week. And what we see is complete absence of the cochlea as well as the vestibule. So you have a flat appearance of the middle ear, the medial wall of the middle ear. You see that many a times the petrous bone is also hypoplastic. And this is an example from the literature. There's a very good article in AJNR which talks about it. So you can see there's complete absence of the inner ear structures. And in this case, you can see that there's a very hypoplastic or almost absent petrous apex on the left side. And I just don't want to kind of stress too much on this, except for the fact that to the undiscerning eye, many a times you can confuse complete labyrinthitis ossificans, that is complete labyrinthitis ossificans of the vestibule and semicircular canal and the cochlea with labyrinthine aplasia. So you want to very closely look at the medial wall of the middle ear cavity. With labyrinthine aplasia, you get a flat middle ear wall. Whereas with, this is a normal appearance, this is the basal turn of the cochlea, and it produces this bulge on the wall, which is called which is the region of the promontory. And this is in a healthy patient, and this is in a patient with labyrinthitis ossificans, and you can see that bulge is still there. So that's how you differentiate between the two. So it's very important to differentiate that. And this is an MR imaging sequence showing you basically no inner ear structures, and the IAC is really small and stenotic. So let's go to the second one, which is basically cochlear aplasia. This is a failure of development during the late third week of gestation. So the cochlea is absent, and we'll go over what the findings are. So in this case, what you're seeing is the cochlea is absent. More often than not, the vestibule and semicircular canals are very dysplastic and abnormal. And you can see the facial nerve has an abnormal course because it's passing through the region where the cochlea should have been. This is the coronal view, which is showing you dysplastic vestibule as lateral as well as superior semicircular canal. I'm not going to spend too much time on this. I just want to show you another example. This is another example on MR, again showing you the cochlea is absent. You can see the dysplastic vestibule as well as the lateral semicircular canal. And this is a coronal view showing the normal side on this normal right side. On the left side, you can see the cochlea is absent at that level. The next one is cochlear hypoplasia. This is a developmental arrest during the sixth week. The cochlea is small in size, but many people, if you read literature, they say less than 2.5 turns. But I think now more and more radiologists that I talk to, they say if it's less than 1.5 turns, they call it hypoplasia. And more often than not, what you see is you just see a single turn. And then the vestibule and semicircular canals are variable, but more often than not, they are dysplastic. So we'll look at some of the examples. Here you look at the cochlea. It's a small cochlea. Look at the the coronal reformat on one side. Look at the normal cochlea on the other side. And look at this. This is like, it doesn't have the complete number of turns. It's an incomplete number of turns. And the right IAC is also slightly smaller compared to the left. So this is cochlear hypoplasia. And then we come to common cavity deformity. This is a common anomaly, around 26% of the cochlear malformations. And we'll go over the imaging findings. So what you see is basically a single cavity with no further differentiation into the cochlea or vestibule. And this is how it looks on imaging. This is a high-resolution CT where you can see there's a single common cavity, but there's no differentiation into cochlea or vestibule. And in this case, the IAC is also widened on that side. This is an MR example, and I have some 3D images to show you on this one. So here you can see this is a common cavity. There is no differentiation into the cochlea or vestibule. You can see over here there is some formation of the posterior semicircular canal, but again, that's variable. You may have them. Sometimes it's absent. Sometimes it may be present or dysplastic. And then this is the three. And many a times with these, if you run a 3D T2 weighted sequence, you can actually do these funky 3D reconstructions. So this is actually a 3D reconstruction of the abnormal side. You can see there is no separation into cochlea or vestibule. You can see some formation of the semicircular canal. This is the normal ear, so you can see there is the normal vestibule, the normal semicircular canals, and this is in another view. I was trying to show you that the cochlea is normal. So another example of common cavity. Now we come to incomplete partition type 1, and I just want you guys to pay attention here because it is more differentiated than the common cavity deformity. So it's just a step ahead of common cavity deformity. Again, you see this kind of figure of eight appearance. The cochlea and vestibule are deformed, but they're still identified separately. And then there's a spectrum of abnormalities. The least differentiated is called the cystic cochleovestibular malformation, which involves the cochlea, the vestibule, as well as the semicircular canals. And then you have the more differentiated form, which is actually the milder form, which involves only the cochlea. So this is how it looks on imaging. So you see this, it almost looks like a figure of eight appearance. So you have a cavity, but there's some differentiation into cochlea as well as vestibule. The semicircular canals may be either normal or most often than not, they're dysplastic. And you want to look for, on imaging, you want to look at the modialis, you want to look at the interscalar septum. And I just want to show you this image here. Oh, it's not projecting that well. So this is actually, I just want this cartoon just to show the residents what we're looking for. So the modialis is, this is a mid-molliolar section. So this is the modialis, this is the cochlear nerve aperture. Basically, the aperture is between the fundus of the internal auditory canal and the modialis. This portion is where we measure for cochlear nerve canal stenosis. And then you have the basal turn here, you have the middle turn and the apical turn. And these structures that separate the apical and middle turn and the middle and the basal turn are called the interscalar septa. So what you see over here is that there is no modialis at all and there are no interscalar septa. So it's a featureless cochlea. Look at the vestibule. The vestibule is like featureless, it's large, and then there is no bone island separating the vestibule from the lateral semicircular canal. And but if you look closely, there is a clear separation between the cochlea and the vestibule. So that's how it's one step ahead of a common cavity malformation. And I have this actually in video just to, you know, sometimes it's hard to perceive it just by, looking at static images. So here you can see that featureless cochlea. There's no modialis, there's no internal architecture. So that's what I wanted to show on the video. This is the second form, the more differentiated form, where this is the normal side for comparison, and here I've shown the abnormal side. So here you can see in the normal patient on MR, you see the modialis and you can see the interscalar septa. And this is on CT, you can see the modialis as well as the interscalar septa. Now look at this case. There is just no modialis and it's got this featureless appearance of the cochlea. So this is the less severe form of IP2. Then we come to incomplete partition type 2. And in this, the developmental arrest occurs during the seventh week. And I just want to show this, a cartoon which will actually kind of bring home the point. So I actually went over this cartoon with you, but this is how IP1 looks. So the one which I talked about previously. So there's no modialis, the interscalar septa are absent. Look at IP2, the modialis is deficient, but there is no, and then you see an interscalar septum between the basal and middle turn, but there is no interscalar septum between the middle and apical turn. So it's an incomplete partition between the apical and middle turn. And then what you see classically on imaging is, you see this, see how it should be normally? This is the middle turn and the apical turn. You should see the interscalar septum. You don't see that over here. So it's this featureless appearance of the apex of the cochlea. And many a times, these patients with IP2 have this dilated vestibular aqueduct. And we'll talk about this when we talk about enlarged vestibular aqueduct also. But it's got this flared appearance of the vestibular aqueduct. And classically, they have this, again, you can see over here, absence of the interscalar septum. Look at the modialis. It's kind of deficient and it's asymmetric. And then look at these very flared and dilated vestibular aqueducts. And classically, this appearance is called the baseball cap appearance of the cochlea. Okay? And once we talk about IP2, we'll get to vestibular aqueduct malformations. And the criteria basically are very well described in this paper in AJNR, and I would recommend people who want to read about it because it's a little exhaustive to just talk about it on this talk. But here's what they measure. They measure the vestibular aqueduct in the mid-isthmus as well as in the opercular portion. And on MR, the equivalent of this is basically an enlarged endolymphatic duct and sac. And I've seen a lot of residents and fellows call it enlarged vestibular aqueduct on MR. So on MR, you don't call it enlarged vestibular aqueduct. On MR, you call it enlarged vestibular duct and sac. And then they present basically with sensorineural hearing loss. This can be either delayed onset, fluctuating, progressive, or post-traumatic. And I know for sure that when I was in Boston, when we saw enlarged vestibular duct on imaging, then many of these patients were, if they were doing contact sports, they were taken off it because they're known to have worsening of their hearing loss with trauma. And in 27 to 40% of them, you see this SLC26A4 mutations. And also an important thing for, I think, a radiologist is to know that it can be associated with Pendred syndrome. Pendred syndrome is basically enlarged vestibular aqueduct associated with goiter. The goiter is not seen at initial clinical presentation. It's seen later on in life. So that's something for the radiologist to suggest in the report so that they can work the patient up for Pendred. So how do you measure the vestibular aqueduct? So you measure it here in the mid portion where it usually should measure around 1 millimeter, and in the opercular portion, it's 2 millimeters. And many a times, like I said, when you see an enlarged vestibular aqueduct, always look at the cochlea because you have that IP2 malformations invariably, if not all. So always pay attention to that area to rule out an IP2 malformation. There's a recent article which talks about the sagittal 45 degree oblique views to assess the vestibular aqueduct, and it's similar to the Pochelle view. It lays out the entire vestibular aqueduct in view, and again you can make the measurements in the isthmic portion as well as the operocular portion. And this is again showing you how it looks on MR. This is an example just to show you normal vestibular aqueduct and a dilated vestibular aqueduct. This is on MR. What you see is dilated duct and sac. Again, flared and enlarged vestibular aqueducts. And especially when you see flared aqueduct, you want to think of that SLC6A4 mutation, especially with these flared aqueducts. Let's look at the inner ear malformations. So you can have either a wide IAC or a small IAC. Wide IAC, it could be a normal variant without any abnormalities. You can have a wide IAC with a lot of inner ear abnormalities. We looked at a few of them. You can see it with NF1 with dural ectasia, and we can see it with NF2 with vestibular schwannomas, but we don't see that in the pediatric age group. We see that more in the adult age group. So the common ones with in the children that we see basically is this X-linked stapes hearing loss or X-linked stapes gusher, and we look at this in the syndromic hearing loss. Small IAC is usually an IAC less than 4 millimeters, but it occurs secondary to hypoplasia or absence of the 8th cranial nerve, because the canal is dependent on the nerve to develop. So if the nerve is not there, then the canal is small. So when you see small IACs, then you should think that the nerve could be deficient. So this is an example showing you absent IAC. This is a normal site for comparison. So you can see there's absent IAC. This is actually large IACs, bulbous and large IACs. This is a stenotic IAC. And then you can see on the MR, what you see is a slit-like IAC, and then there's only the 7th cranial nerve in there. There's absence of the cochlea as well as the vestibular nerves. And then let's get to the cochlear nerve malformations. So the cochlear nerve deficiency, actually before I get to there, let's say, so CT is very poor for assessing the cochlear nerve, right? Because we don't see the contents of the IAC. You can actually see the bony IAC, but you don't see the contents of the IAC. So to assess the cochlear nerve, you want to do MR. But the CT equivalent of that is, you can make a suggestion of it, is when you see narrowing of the cochlear nerve aperture, and I'll talk about that. So what we want to do is thin section T2 weighted images, and when you have an absence of the cochlear nerve, the cochlear implants are generally contraindicated. So this is a normal image through the IAC. So this is a mnemonic that the residents use, 7-up, coke down. Then this is anterior, this is posterior, and then you have the superior and inferior vestibular nerves. So again, on MRs, 7th nerve, 8th nerve, superior and inferior vestibular nerves. Now usually the 8th cranial nerve is equal to or larger than the 7th nerve, and it's usually larger than the superior and inferior vestibular nerves. So this is an example. This was what I was talking about. So this is the cochlear nerve aperture. So it's between this is the porus of the IAC. This is the fundus of the IAC. So this is the cochlear nerve aperture. Between the fundus as well as the modilis is the cochlear nerve aperture. So you want to measure that. So if you have on CT, it's called stenotic if it's less than 1.7 millimeters. And on MR over here, obviously what you're trying to see on MR is this is a normal patient, the cochlear nerve canal is of normal width. On MR, you see all 4 nerves in the IAC. This is a patient with cochlear nerve stenosis. You can see that this is narrowed. It measures less than 1.7 millimeters. And when you do the MR, this is the other way around. This is the left side. So this is anterior and this is posterior. So you can see the 7th nerve is larger than the 8th, and the 8th is also smaller than the superior and inferior vestibular nerve. So this is cochlear nerve hypoplasia. And this is another extreme example. This is over here, you don't see the cochlear nerve canal at all. This is called cochlear nerve canal atresia, and the cochlea is trapped at this point. And then in those cases, what you see is cochlear nerve aplasia. So you see the 7th, you see the inferior and superior and inferior vestibular nerves, but you don't see the cochlear nerve. And then, vestibular and semicircular malformations, I'll quickly brief over it. Because they're not, I'm talking about charge in the syndromic form, so we'll look at that in the syndromic forms. Here's an example of an abnormal vestibule. This is a dilated vestibule, and in this case, there was also cochlear aperture stenosis. This is another example. This is like you see the the vestibule is dysplastic, and there's no bone island separating the vestibule from the lateral semicircular canal. The semicircular canal is incorporated into the vestibule, so this is another abnormality. Coming to the syndromic hearing loss, this is the whole big exhaustive list. I'm not going to go through all of them, but I'm going to touch the major ones, like I said, which imaging will help in diagnosis. So I'll talk about CHARGE. So CHARGE basically is an acronym that stands for coloboma, heart anomaly, atresia coenae, retardation of growth, genital anomalies, and ear anomalies. The major criteria are the four C's. So that's coloboma, atresia coenae, and characteristic ear abnormalities. And then in 2008, they added another one, which is the fourth C, which is cranial nerve involvement. So classically, what you see on MR is basically these colobomas. You see those colobomas, these small outpouchings from the eye. They have coenal atresia, which you see there. This is a membranous form of coenal atresia. And they have very characteristic MR imaging findings, or even CT temporal bone findings. It's something which the radiologist can suggest. That's the reason I'm showing it to you. They have this very characteristic abnormality where they have a very dysplastic and small vestibule, and all the semicircular canals are absent. And the EAC has got this funny abnormal funnel shape to it. Obviously, they have other malformations. I don't have time to go through every small one of them, but we'll look at the major ones. So here it is. So you can see this is the vestibule. Look at how small it is. This is small, and then there were no semicircular canals at all. And this is the funnel-shaped IEC that I was talking about. Look at that. It's like almost anteroposteriorly oriented and very abnormal in shape. This is how it looks on CT temporal bones. Just a very small dysplastic vestibule, no semicircular canals. And these are the other findings. So when you see something like that in the ear, then you start looking for other anomalies and you start seeing so many of them. I have one of these papers in publication. We looked at all the other findings in CHARGE. So what you see here is this basal occiput. There's a hypoplasia of the clivus. They have inferior vermian hypoplasia. They have pontine hypoplasia. And then the cranial nerves, look at the olfactory nerves. They're really tiny. This is another patient. One side is missing, the other side is small. So you want to look at the cranial nerves very closely in a patient with CHARGE. And this is an example. Obviously, many a times we're not able to make this diagnosis prenatally, but this is an example that I saw while I was at Boston. So this kid actually has this fetal ultrasound showing abnormal pinna. This is the fetal MR actually showing you pontine hypoplasia as well as mild inferior vermian hypoplasia. And we looked at the inner ear, so you could just see the cochlea, but there was no formation of the vestibule. And you could also see the coenal atresia in this case, and in this case showing you just the pontine hypoplasia. See how the AP diameter, the transverse diameter of the pons is really reduced. So we could not make a diagnosis of CHARGE prenatally, but I'm just showing you so that, you know, people who see a lot of fetal MRs can actually suggest this prenatally. Next one is branchioautorenal syndrome. It's an autosomal condition. Basically, it consists of hearing loss. They have auricular malformations, as well as branchial arch closure defects, usually preauricular pits and tags, and they have renal anomalies. There are mutations of two genes, the EYA1 gene, which is the most common one, and then you have the SIX mutation. So this is the only case I've seen in my life, and this is supposed to be the characteristic BOR finding. So they have this classical tapered appearance of the basal turn of the cochlea. Normally, the basal turn is of one thickness throughout. Now, in this case, you can see that it is thick at one end, but the other end it's tapered. And then look at this unmound. It's called this unmound appearance of the cochlea. There's a separation between the apical, the basal and the middle turns. It's like they're not stacked one over the other. They're like opened up. So it's called the unwound appearance of the cochlea. The IACs are anteroposteriorly oriented. Normally the IACs are we see them more horizontally oriented. This one is more anteroposteriorly oriented. They have huge eustachian tubes. Look at the size of those eustachian tubes. Big ones. Many a times they have bilateral external auditory canal atresia. So that is another syndromic cause of external auditory canal atresia that you want to look for. Dysmorphic ossicles. And then many of these patients have abnormalities of the branchial arch apparatus. So you can see over here this patient has branchial cleft cyst. This is another image. And then they have renal anomalies. In this patient, the kidney is hyperechoic and it has multiple cysts. I think this is the last of my the syndromic ones. This is actually another interesting example of how radiologists can make the diagnosis. It's also called X-linked mixed hearing loss or conductive hearing loss with stapes fixation. It's X-linked recessive. Males are affected, and this is the mutation. It's basically a POOF mutation or the POU3F4 mutation. And we look at the imaging, but what I want to say is there's a wide communication in this condition between the. You don't have the modalis, you don't have the lamina cribrosa, you don't have the interscalar septum. There's a wide communication with the CSF space and the perilymph. So if you, if they also, many of these patients also have congenital fixation of the stapes, so when you operate, they have these, they have the CSF gusher, so you don't want to operate these patients for the stapes problem. So this is how it looks on imaging. It's this characteristic appearance is called the corkscrew cochlea. I don't know why my cursor is not showing up. So this is, actually sometimes it can be a little confusing with the IP1, but I'll show you how to differentiate. So it's this very characteristic corkscrew appearance. It's very different from the IP1. And then you have this, the lateral portion of the IACs are widened. So let me show you on MR. See how it looks? It's this characteristic corkscrew appearance. And look at the, there's no modialis, there is just very mild formation of the interscalar septum, but not much. Whereas in IP1, you just don't have any interscalar formation. And then look at the IACs. The lateral portion of the IACs are wide and, you know, large. And just to show you again, this is how IP1 looks. So there's no modialis, no interscalar septum. In IP3, what you see is no modialis, but there's some formation of the interscalar septum. So the cochlea has that kind of corkscrew appearance and not, it has got at least some features compared to an IP1, which is like almost featureless. The other one is trisomy 21. This is also something which you can look for, and people have described it. The most common one that you see is basically small bone island of the lateral semicircular canal. So this bone island should actually measure around 3 millimeters. If it's less than 3 millimeters, you call it abnormal. And this is an example showing you a small bone island of the lateral semicircular canal. And this is, again, an example of that. The vestibule is a little large and the bone island is small. This is a video, if I can play it. So see that, how small that bone island is? It's really tiny. So that's something to remember. And we've actually gone most of the, so Pendred syndrome is almost very similar to IP2, but it's just that you should know that this syndrome exists. And it's basically a mutation of SLC226A4 mutation. And this codes for Pendrin protein. And this Pendrin protein is an iron transporter. It's expressed in thyroid, kidney, and inner ear. And that's why you have thyroid as well as inner ear problems. And something which the radiologists can suggest, and they can work them up for this. And then I really don't, there's not much imaging literature. I mean, I've shown you BOR, but Waardenburg and Allergy is something which is very evident to the clinician. It's something they have very characteristic faces, and the clinicians usually make the diagnosis clinically. So we don't see too much imaging of this. But Waardenburg is, like, I just want to show to the radiologists who don't see much of this, you know, they have this white forelock, very striking blue eyes. This, they have this dystopia canthorum, so the medial canthus is laterally placed, and they have a broad nasal root. And the abnormality is typically of the posterior semicircular canal. Remember I told you there were two conditions which can have abnormalities of the posterior semicircular canal. So one of them is this Waardenburg syndrome, the other one is Allergy's. But I don't have examples of this because we don't image them that often, because the clinicians are very good at making the diagnosis. So in summary, we went through a lot. I just want to kind of summarize the differential diagnosis. So when you see EAC stenosis, you want to look if there is micrognathia. If there is micrognathia, if it is unilateral, you think of the hemifacial microsomia spectrum. If it's bilateral, you think of Treacher-Collins-Nagar's as well as BOR. If you have a small vestibule and semicircular canal, if it's a small vestibule and absent semicircular canal, think of CHARGE. If you have only abnormalities of the posterior semicircular canal, think of Waardenburg's, branchiotorenal as well as Allergy's. These are the three differentials. There's nothing else that can give you just absence of posterior semicircular canal. If you see cochlear abnormalities, this is normal. This is a baseball cap cochlea. It is seen in IP2 and Pendred. If you see unwound cochlea like you see over here, that is in BOR. If you see a corkscrew cochlea, then it is X-linked mixed hearing loss. If you see a large vestibular aqueduct, if it's a flared aqueduct, think of SLC26A4 mutation. And if you see a funnel-shaped vestibular aqueduct, think of CHARGE. So like I said, imaging findings may provide a specific diagnosis in these conditions, especially the SLC26A4 mutations, the branchiotorenal syndrome, CHARGE syndrome, and the X-linked mixed hearing loss. Thank you.
Very nice, very illustrative. Any questions for Dr. Lika?
Yeah. Yes.
It's very nice presentation.
Thank you.
And in terms of the diagnostic aspect, in terms of management aspect, what proportion or to what extent is the neuroradiology can help in terms of coming up with things that require additional treatment? in addition to what's currently, let's say, CMV, medication, and cochlear implant?
I'm not sure if I got the entire question. Your question was that what does radiology do in addition to, in terms of treatment?
Yeah, in terms of management, what proportion do you see 5% of cases?
So I think in my personal experience, I've seen a lot of CMV infections missed. Like I said, you know, I've seen a lot of the obviously not in this. Once you have it late, I think the gamcitabine helps if you pick it up early, you can treat it. Treat it with gamcitabine. But once they are like a few years old and you see these findings, I don't think you can treat their hearing loss. But you can make a diagnosis. Many of them have seen they didn't have a diagnosis of CMV, and they had all these imaging findings which were being quoted as, you know, leukodystrophy, because many people who don't read too many pediatric neuroradiology scans actually misdiagnose CMV as leukodystrophy. I've seen enough and more cases of that. And then the second thing is, I think the cochlear nerve deficit, if the cochlear nerve is absent, and it's a, I mean, I don't know what the new ENT literature says, but my understanding is that you don't need a cochlear implant in those states. So I think those are the two things that I can think of where it's kind of impacted a little bit in the management of the patients. Otherwise, I think it's just telling them, like I said, with the external auditory canal atresia, what to avoid, what are the underlying abnormalities, you know, just being descriptive and telling you what the malformation is.
Just I'm saying that CMV is actually sensory neural loss for like 90% of the patient. affecting the bones or something. They had no treatment as a treatment, even get self-treatment or anything. Only might just a suppression of the to get something else. Just interferons, for example, because the delay in talking or speaking or language wise, and also in education, it is going to be the interference, but to help exactly that nerve damage, not yet.
So I want to congratulate you on an excellent talk, and I just wish our ENT residents were here to listen to this. It's just a question. I mean, we don't see that kind of detail, you know, on our images. Is it a software issue? Is it
type
of scanner?
No. So some of these scans that I showed you were actually done on the 1.5, which they have here. It's basically a sequence that, it's available on different scanners. It's just different names. I think the GE side, they call it CIS or KISS. And on the on the Siemens side, they call it CIS. On the GE side, it's called Fiesta. So
Fiesta.
I don't know if you all have Fiesta.
We have Fiesta.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's something which is bread and butter. You just have to have a small field of view. I think the most important thing is planning. I would prefer it. Do 3D, do high resolution imaging, and then I like the Boston technique where you do direct sagittal, T2 sagittal images, because I think when you do direct, the reformatted images sometimes are, reformatting it from an isotropic volume, but I feel the detail that you see on a direct sagittal is like much better than what you would do with the reformats. But I think this is something which you can do on a 1.5 or 3T, it doesn't require anything special.
With that in mind, I enjoyed your presentation.
Thank you.
The problem of dehiscence of the superior semicircular canal, which produces such strange symptoms, is frequently overlooked. Say a word about the ability to target the superior canal directly so that you can be very certain that there is or is not a dehiscence.
So, you know, I know a lot of people actually, some people say, oh, do MRs, and they say you can pretty much become even sensory neural hearing loss, superior semicircular canal dehiscence on MR, but I think CT is the way to go for superior semicircular canal dehiscence. And then the best thing to do is actually the Stenberg's view that I was talking about and the Boschel view. It lays out the entire superior semicircular canal, you know, because sometimes it's just thin bone, and if you're just looking at the axon images, if it's thin bone, you can misdiagnose just. It's there, but it's very thin, you can misdiagnose that position. So doing the Pochels and the Stenberg's reconstructions kind of helps, I think, me to make that diagnosis more comfortable. But I think, I've seen superior semicircular canal dehiscence in kids, but not so common like in adults. I think I've seen it more commonly in adults than kids.
Thank you. And one follow-up to that. You bring us such advanced technique, it appears to me. In Meniere's disease, endolymphatic high drops can be very difficult to be certain of the diagnosis. Is there any recent work with MR technology that will show us the amount of of indolent so that we can make that diagnosis?
Not yet, I think, not yet. But I would just like to add that, you know, the GJB2 mutations I was talking about, initially the teaching was that you don't get any depth of bone mutation of abnormalities in GJB2, but now people know what morphine and activity. Now people are talking about mild modal deficiency as well as endolymphatic mild vascular aqueduct dilatation. So I think as we get better and better at imaging, we might reach a point where we would probably be able to tell you that, but I'm not at this point of time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.